Morning, Paz. Assalamualaikum. Alright. So we have reached the chapter of thin film solar cell. So far, we have learned the monocrystalline silicon solar cell. So we have learned that the problem of monocrystalline silicon solar cell is that the cost of production is not that cheap. It is expensive because of the Zocras process, which transforms the silicon dioxide to pure silicon, pure monocrystalline silicon, and the technology is very expensive. So we need to learn new technology which provides cheaper solution to produce solar cell, which is known as the second generation solar cell, the thin film solar cell. And we have few technologies in the category of thin film solar cell. So these are the learning outcomes to understand the need for second generation solar cell. Well, the motivation is that we need to find cheaper and easier solution to produce or to fabricate solar cell. And this is the second generation. The first generation is the monocrystalline silicon. So the second generation, these are the technologies that so far has been established in the R&D. So we need to learn the cadmium telluride based solar cell. Next, the copper indium gallium sulfide solar cell. Next, the copper zinc tin sulfide solar cell, or CZTS. And last one is amorphous silicon solar cell. Do not pronounce this as acid, no. This is hydrogenated amorphous silicon. Hydrogenated amorphous silicon. And finally, we need to understand the method to estimate thickness, amount, and price of material used to fabricate a thin film solar cell. So in this case, we only focus on the CVT-based thin film solar cell. We need to understand the calculation, how the calculation is being done to calculate, to estimate the amount of tellurium needed. Why tellurium? Because it is considered as rare metal on planet Earth. The price is expensive, but not as expensive as the Zokrowski process. Rare material means that the availability of the material is not that easy to find. In 1 million of silicon atom, we only could find 0.5 something atom, not 0.5, sorry. 0.0 something atom of tellurium. In 1 million silicon, only 0.0 something tellurium will be found on planet Earth. So it is very rare. Now, this is the photovoltaic market scenario. The monocrystalline silicon solar cell dominates 90% of the photovoltaic market. The price, however, is not cheap. Still dominated by the monocrystalline silicon. Why? Because of the performance, the durability. Even though it is expensive, but still, it dominates the market. And we still could not afford to buy the solar cell to generate electricity for our house. We need to spend more than 50k. So the thin film solar cell is proposed due to cheaper materials processing and lesser amount of materials needed. We only need this thick of material, 3 to 10 micrometers. So we need little amount. Only little amount of material to produce or to fabricate the thin film solar cell. Later we will learn how to calculate them. CDTE or cadmium telluride, amorphous silicon, copper indium gallium selenide, or sometimes indium sulfide, and copper zinc tin sulfide, CZTS, are among the light absorber used in thin film solar cell. However, they have some other risk. For example, toxicity. Cadmium is toxic. Availability. Tellurium is rare. Performance issues. All the CDTE, CIGS, CZTS, and ASIH, they have performance issues. The highest performance is only about 20%. How about monocrystalline silicon? Nearly 30% already. So we have these issues. Even though it is cheap, we have toxicity issue, availability, and performance issue. Three issues. So still, the best option for light absorber is still silicon. But these are some insights. If you want to use silicon, these are some drawbacks or some pros and cons. expensive processing of monocrystalline silicon. To produce monocrystalline silicon, the technology is very expensive. So we could use cheaper monocrystalline, polycrystalline silicon, which is PSI processing technology. Zokralski need to be used to fabricate the monocrystalline silicon, but it's expensive. So we could use polycrystalline. We could make polycrystalline silicon even without the Zokralski. So it could be cheaper. However, let us see about the performance. The polycrystalline silicon solar cell performance still need to be optimized. It is not as high as the monocrystalline silicon. Why? We have the reason. Let me go to that section. So if polycrystalline silicon is cheaper, however the performance still need to be optimized, we try to look at the amorphous silicon. It is even cheaper than the polycrystalline silicon. However, still performance issue is the main hindrance. Next, it has lower than that of the monocrystalline silicon. Still, amorphous polycrystalline, they have lower efficiency than that of the monocrystalline silicon. How about availability? Silicon is the most abundant material on planet Earth. You step out from this lab, we could find silicon in form of silicon dioxide. Even in this lab also, we have silicon dioxide in the ceramic tile. Toxicity, silicon is non-toxic. The only issue is that we need this monocrystalline, but the price is very expensive. That is the only issue of silicon solar cell. The monocrystalline silicon solar cell. We could use poly, we could use amorphous, however, the performance is the main issue. Now, let us see the features of second generation solar cell. If we want to use the amorphous or the polycrystalline, CDTE, CZPS, CIGS, they are cheaper, flexible, and lightweight. Even though the performance is lower than monocrystalline silicon, so we could install our solar cell or solar panel on top of boat, on top of car, or on our bag, on our clothes. We are working towards that. On our bag, on a tent, we are using this. On buggy car. Buggy car kan, nama operator golf. Let us see the first technology, which is the CDTE thin film solar cell. CDTE is used as primary light absorber. The main light absorber, it absorbs light and generates excited state electron. However, and it provides lower production cost than the monocrystalline silicon solar cell. We don't need to use Zokralski. We could use any colloidal technique or thermal evaporator or chemical bath deposition or chemical vapor deposition, which is easier than the Zokralski. However, cadmium is toxic. But the important thing is the cadmium telluride solar cell is recyclable. We could recycle the material again. Extract the material out from the damaged CDTE solar cell and reuse for other solar cell. Tellurium is rare material, limiting factor for industrial scalability. If you want to scale up the process, if you manage to invent a prototype and you want to scale up, you want to do a mass production and you have a partner from the industry, the first thing that usually ask you is that, is your raw material easily available? If you use rare metals, definitely do not be scaled up, because the availability of the material is very hard to find. So CDTE technology is used at the largest photovoltaic power station, Topaz Solar Farm, in US, about 35 km area. It produces 550 megawatt production. This is the device structure of CDTE solar cell. We have metal contact, usually we use titanium. Kak Farha, korang. She's working on C similar device structure, but not CDTE. She's using PBS, PBSDA, PBDE, and we are aiming to use titanium metal. However, our thermal evaporator machine is not that efficient. We have sent the machine to the supplier to modify a little bit to lower the vacuum. I mean, to make sure the TE could reach until 10 to the power of negative 6 bar of vacuum, such that it will lower the vaporization temperature of any metal. So we are aiming to vaporize titanium using our machine. The vaporization temperature is about 1760 degrees. So if we manage to do that, we could make similar device structure with new material. So they are using cadmium sulfide and cadmium telluride. We are aiming for lead sulfide and lead telluride. Forget about the toxicity. We try to venture new type of material to make solar cell. So this, the name of this titanium is back contact, which is cathode. It's front contact, glass substrate, and sternum oxide. The glass substrate is normal glass. Sternum oxide is the material that makes the glass substrate conductive. The glass is conducting electricity because of this sternum oxide. This is tin oxide. The other name for sternum is tin. This is tin oxide. And usually we dope with fluorine or indium. CDS is window layer. CDTE is the main light absorber. We are aiming that the light will be absorbed strongly by the CDTE. CDS is only window layer to widen the wavelength range that is being absorbed by our device. We need to look at the band gap. Then you will understand the meaning of widening the range of absorbed wavelength. So, incident light coming from this side, definitely not from this side. Incident light. This is transparent, sternum oxide, transparent. In CDS also is transparent because the thickness is very thin, about 0.1 to 0.5 micrometer only. So light will be absorbed by the CDTE as well. CDTE has small band gap, which is 1.45 electron volts. It absorbs low energy light. The near infrared, the red light will be absorbed by the CDTE. How about the higher energy of light? Still could be absorbed by the CDTE, but we prepare a window layer, which means the orange, the yellow, the green, blue, indigo, violet will be absorbed strongly by the CDS. So CDS, why it absorbs high energy light? Because the band gap is higher than the band gap of CDTE. Supporting only. CDS provides a supporting light absorber. Yeah.
Fungsi window layer dan crystal.
Fungsi
window layer
to assist the light absorbing property. Without CDS, if we just put CDTE and SNO2 and TI, no photovoltaic could be generated because we don't have the separating layer. We need PN junction, kan? If no CDS, the excited state electron from the CDTE, nowhere to go. It will keep on recombining with the hole at CDTE. So we need to create another layer which the electron or the hole could be injected.
So the reason why electron is lebih besar daripada yang absorber ini, kan?
Yes. Why? Because this one is absorbing low energy light, and it will still keep on absorbing high energy light. Third, now this one usually we put the wider band gap material such that it will absorb the high energy light as well. So it will be the supporting in two ways. It support to produce the photovoltaic effect, and another one to support to produce extra exciton by absorbing high energy light.
So maksudnya kalau contoh energy light tu rendah untuk CDS tapi tinggi untuk CDTE tu still tak boleh function lah.
Come again?
Contoh CDS tu kan, kan dia untuk high energy light punya So kalau kata dia kita supply energy light yang rendah, tapi CCTV boleh terima, CDS tak boleh terima.
Yes, correct. Correct. Both of them has function. So that means it widens the spectrum, the absorption of light spectrum. The longer light spectrum will be absorbed by the CDTA. The shorter light spectrum will be absorbed by the CDS. Widen the absorption of spectrum. Okay. So the rate of photovoltaic conversion efficiency using this scheme is about 19.6% by GE Global Research. High speed of photon production, easy, very easy to produce, and long-term stability about 20 years. Even though the cadmium is toxic, tellurium is rare, it provides these advantages. The only limiting factor is that this tellurium. Why must you become rare? Why can't you be abundant? What is the most abundant material besides silicon on planet Earth? Carbon. If we could transform carbon into something that is useful to make solar cells, we are going to be rich. We should find that. Now, nowadays people already could transform carbon into graphene, fullerene, Buckminster fullerene. They have other functions for electronics, but not for photovoltaic materials. So if we could transform them by modifying the structure, who knows? We could use them for solar cell. We just need to find the way, the technique to modify them. Okay. So how do we calculate the tellurium? We focus on tellurium only because tellurium is rare. We couldn't afford to waste any tellurium. Expensive is number two. But the most important thing is we do not waste any tellurium. We must calculate the exact amount of tellurium that we need for the fabrication. So this is formula is very simple. Thickness of the CDTE layer times density times mass fraction of TE. I will explain the mass fraction later. So let's say we are about to fabricate a 2 micrometer thick of cadmium telluride layer. So the thickness 2 micrometer is about 0.0002 centimeter. And the density is about 5.7 gram per centimeter cube. And mass fraction for time being just take 0.52. I will explain later where did I get this figure. Plug in everything, you got the value. So it's about 5.928 gram per meter square. We transform this into a sentence. We need 5.928 gram of tellurium to fabricate 1 meter square CDTE layer with thickness of 2 micrometer. So if you are a production engineer, you are about to fabricate 1 meter times 1 meter CDTE solar panel with a thickness of 2 micrometer. You need this amount of tellurium, only 6 gram. Very, very small. So now, what is mass fraction, which is 0.52? We could easily determine using FISM and EDX. Have you used FISM and EDX before? Pernah pakai? Have you used FISM? Field emission electron, field emission scanning electron microscope. It's an electron microscope. So usually we will get this image. We could measure the thickness and we could detect which one is CDTE layer. We need to pinpoint, tell the machine that this is CDTE layer. I want to analyze the component of CDTE layer. Then we need to use PX. We tell the system that this is CDTE layer. I want to analyze the CDTE layer. And this is the result of PX. So it shows that the element here that you point out to the computer, the mass fraction, the mass percentage of cadmium is 48%. The mass percentage for tellurium is 52%. So 52% is 0.5. the stoichiometry of CDT is 1 CD, 1 TE kan? Stoichiometry dia 1 CD, CDTE 1 mol CD, 1 mol TE or 1 atom of cadmium, 1 atom of TE. That is just approximation. But the real thing is you could measure using EDX. It is not exactly 1-1. It is, if 1-1, this is supposed to be 50% and 50%. It's actually 48% cadmium, 52% tellurium. So this is mass fraction of TE, about 0.52, which is 52%.
Aku more version of EDX.
What else?
What else?
What EDX usually the postgrads, the students, the researchers, we want to make sure. Let's say we have fabricated something. We claim that this is TiO2 layer. How do we exactly know if that is TiO2? One, we could use XRD. If your layer you put in XRD and it gives the peak of TiO2, it is confirmed TiO2. But how about the structure? Sometimes, if your sample is only TiO2, it is easy. Okay, confirm this is TiO2. But how about it is mixed with something else? TiO2 plus CdSe. Then it shows figure something like this. You have CdTe over here, and you have other material over here. So which one is CdTe? Which one is the other material? So you want to see the structure. You cannot just guess, this is CDTE. You have to tell the system, I want to analyze this. What is the material of this layer? Tak? Okay, any more questions? EDX, XRD? EDX, XRD lah.
Betul?
Yeah.
Macam biasa kalau kita dapat barang
yang
kita ikut.
Nak buat barang?
Jadi macam tadi satu mol of CD.
Okay.
Then bila kita dapat barang tu, kita dapat tahu yang sebenarnya kan satu-satu di 0.52 dengan 0.4 apa yang kita
buat. Okay.
Jadi jadi yang 0.5 untuk next calculation, untuk jadikan perfect couple, kita kena guna yang 0.52 kan untuk greater di 10 yang
example of calculations.
Macam untuk tank, berapa gram CD untuk campur dengan berapa gram TE.
Do not use this one. Do not use this one. Just use the approximate version, the 1-1L, 2-1. We have one more instrument to double confirm the XRP. Sometimes if your material is too small, nano size, nano 1 nano 2 nano, sometimes the XRD won't give you the exact graph, and you are not sure whether your material is exactly TiO2 ga, but because the graph is very different, the bulk graph of XRD and the graph for nano size will be different, and you cannot be sure whether your material is exactly TiO2 or not. So we have one more instrument that could double confirm the result. When you are dealing with nano size material, you are using XRD. XRD is the main source of XRD is X-ray. The wavelength of X-ray is 's not precise enough to characterize nano size sample, because the wavelength is considered big or long. So we need smaller wavelength of source, not X-ray, not visible light. We need electron beam. So we could use TEM, transmission electron microscope, which the wavelength of electron is smaller than the wavelength of X-ray. So if the smaller the wavelength, it means that the machine will be precise. So using TEM, or the transmission electron microscope, we could generate a result which is nearly similar to that of the XRD, and fine-tune the result of the XRD and double confirm that the material that we have produced is the material that you are desired. we could double confirm it using TEM. So TEM, XRD, they are like brother and sister. They are like siblings. They complement each other. So, next question. How much power is generated in every gram of tellurium? Need to estimate. Consider that if your device is working with 10% of efficiency, with this much amount of tellurium. So the power generated per gram is that we have Pin. What is the value of Pin? The standard one cell. Pin. Standard Pin, one sun. Me, one what? 1 sun. 1 sun. What is Pin? Me. 1,000 watt per meter square. It's constant. 1 sun, 1,000 watt per meter square. So if our device is working with 10% of efficiency, 10% times the Pin, we only could generate about 16.87 watts. That is P out of our device. So the question is, how much power is generated in every gram of tellurium? That's divided by the gram per meter square, which we have calculated here. The amount of tellurium needed. Divided by amount of tellurium needed, then you got 16.87 watt per gram. So we transform this into a sentence, it will come like this. About 16.87 watts will be generated in every 1 gram of tellurium. Small amount, 1 gram, we could produce this much of power. That's great. 1 gram. About, looks like a sprinkle of dust. 1 gram, right? You got 100 gram, 1 gram. So how about the price? Price of tellurium per generator pot. So based on the price of tellurium in 2014, it cost about 971 ringgit per gram. Sorry, per kilogram. 1 kilogram, we need to spend about 971 ringgit. So we have calculated that 16.87 watt is produced in every 1 gram of tellurium. So the cost of tellurium in every 1 watt production, we could calculate like this. We know that price of tellurium per gram is this much. 1000 gram, the cost is 971. 1000 gram, the cost is 971. So, if 100 gram of tellurium, how much it costs me? Darab silam, 1 gram times 971 divided by 1000, we got 0.971, about 1 ringgit. 1 ringgit need to be spent to buy 1 gram of tellurium. So next stage then, we need to calculate the tellurium needed to produce 1 watt. We have calculated this. About 16.87 watt will be generated in 1 gram of tellurium. Darab silam, 1 watt times 1 gram divided by 16.87, we got 0.06 gram. Now, finally, we could calculate the price of tellurium to produce 1 watt. Just, this is simple mathematics, 0.06 gram times 0.901 ringgit, about 0.06 ringgit. To produce 1 watt, we need to spend 0.06 ringgit to buy tellurium. This is considered as cheap.
So let's say waktu banyak apa ya? Let's say waktu tellurium yang kita akan buat apa sebelum ni?
Depends on the thickness. If we want 2 micrometer of thickness of CDTE, we need to use this conversion factor. We need 5.6 gram per meter square. 1 meter about this area, this length, this long kan? 1 meter, we need about 6 gram of tellurium. Sikit.
Lebih mahal kan?
Yes, 1 kilo about 1,000 ringgit.
Tapi Zukrovsky.
Still cheaper. Still cheaper than the Zukrovsky. And easier and faster. Zukrovsky, you need to wait for one whole day to just to prepare the ingot. When you got ingot, you need to slice the ingot. You need to dope P and N junction. See, not just Zukrovsky, the doping process also expensive. So, summary of CDT technology, theoretical efficiency 30%. Any bulk solar cell, any solar cell except the quantum dot solar cell, the theoretical efficiency is about 30%, 31 or 32, like that. Now, the lab cell efficiency in laboratory, they managed to fabricate the solar cell as high as 19.6% of efficiency only. This is lab scale. How about module? We combine all the cell, becomes module. And in the form of module, the efficiency drop about 13% only. From 19, it becomes 13. Because of the soldering action, the resistance that every cell made, so the efficiency will be dropped. So estimated production cost, the whole solar cell, the whole panel, is about 3 ringgit 90 cent per watt. The one that we have calculated, this is the price to buy tellurium only. So besides tellurium, we need to buy cadmium, we need to buy titanium, we need to buy CDX, SNO2. So the whole total cost is about 3 ringgit and 90 cent. From this 3 ringgit 90 cent, we need to spend only 0.06% to buy the tellurium, produce 1 watt. Stability is good, cadmium is toxic, tellurium is rare. That is the problem. Now we need to find another technology. We have tried cadmium and tellurium. X axis is atomic number, Y axis is abundance of the material, atoms of element per 1 million atoms of silicon. So, if you read like this, arsenic, it shows 1. What does it mean? It means that in 1 million atoms of silicon, we could find only 1 atom of arsenic. So, cadmium is about 0.9. So in 1 million of silicon atom is one, we could find 0.9 atom of cadmium. How about tellurium? Even red. In 1 million silicon atom, we could only find 0.0003 atom of tellurium. Yes, 0.001 atom of tellurium. Rarest metal, palladium, rhenium, ruthenium, tellurium, I can't remember what is RE. Aurum mask, the one that you wear, that's why it is expensive, because it is rarest metal. Platinum, I can't remember. OS is osmium, RE I can't remember. RH is rhenium, RE is, this is ruthenium, rhenium, palladium, tellurium, osmium, platinum, aurum, professional engineer. No. So people working on other metals, for example, sulfur. In 1 million silicon, we have 1000 sulfur. Copper, gallium. However, we could not use this combination, copper, gallium, sulfur. It won't show any interesting properties. They still have to depend on indium. They have to combine copper, indium, gallium sulfide to produce something that is interesting, which could absorb infrared light. Why do we need to absorb infrared light? Do you still remember? Why do we need to aim the infrared light or the near infrared? Why? tak dapat jawab tu, dia pun tak dengar. Why?
No.
Yeah, partially true. Partially true. We need to produce more exciton, kan? Because it shows at the high intensity of absorbing capability at near infrared. If we combine copper, gallium, helium, and sulfide. If you use copper, gallium, and sulfide, the band gap is not that small as the CIGS. Now next is CIGS. Copper, indium, gallium, sometimes we use selenide, sometimes we use sulfide. Both of them nearly have similar properties. So they absorb light strongly. Very small amount of CIGS is needed in fabrication. It's even cheaper than the CVTE because indium doesn't fall into the category of rare earth metals. Nearly fall to the rare earth metal, but the price is still not as expensive as indium. So the pros is thin film CIGS is flexible. We could bend the solar cell like this. Able to be deposited on flexible substrate at low temperature. People are now working on fabricating the solar cell on
shirt.
Wash the lama. Shirt. But however, toxicity issue still. People trying to get away from the toxicity issue. You know, we have sulfur. Sometimes when the sulfur release, you will smell like a rotten egg. We don't want to wear any clothes that will smell like rotten egg because we have sulfur. He has a point. Smart clothes. Self-drying clothes. Just push a button. Automatic fan, the nano fan inside your shirt functioning. Have you watched the film Tuxedo? Jackie Chan. Then smart shirt. You could do anything. The electronic part is built in your shirt. Okay, there is one philosopher I met. I can't remember what is his name. It was about 12 years ago. I met him at UKM. I can't remember his name. He's not Malaysian. He's invited professor from I can't remember. Anyway, his philosophy is this. If you could imagine anything, it means that technology we could do. For example, if you imagine that, oh, one day I could fly just using a very small jetpack at my back. It means that if you could imagine, technology is producible, could be fabricated. We just need to think how. Before the era of smartphone, before we could touch the screen of a smartphone, in the movie Star Wars about 1970 something, they have used touch screen computer, even though they have not been invented yet. So if anything you could imagine, it means that instrument could be invented. So that is his philosophy. The things that we cannot imagine, we cannot do. As long as we could imagine, we could. We just need to find out how. So this is the device structure of CIGS or CIGS. We could fabricate the layer onto glass, metal foil or plastic. We use molybdenum, CIGS, CDS and zinc oxide. This is the basic device structure. And the band gap of CIGS is about 1.1 micron. And it is absorbing near infrared light. The important thing is it is flexible and we could make our solar cell in the form of tube or cylindrical shape because it is flexible. Cylindrical shape. What is the advantage of making this device structure? What advantage that we heat could absorb light from any direction? For example, if the sunlight, if the sun rise from here and set in the direction, we just need to put our solar panel in the direction of the light, in the trajectory of the light. Okay. Sunrise over here, still absorbing. Okay, noon, still absorbing. Sunset, still absorbing. And furthermore, the light from the ground is being reflected, and we still could absorb the sunlight from the reflected light from these surfaces. So, it's flexible, you can make it in the form of cylinder. What are the advantages? It is more stable, because the airflow could pass through easily within the slit between the solar cell. This is the conventional design. The rigid type of monocrystalline silicon, unstable. If the wind is too strong, it could lift up our solar cell and damage it. The cylindrical shape of CIGS is very efficient. Conventional design is not efficient. It would lift up our conventional silicon solar cell. The summary of CIGS, theoretical efficiency, as I mentioned before, any bulk solar cell except a quantum dot solar cell. The theoretical efficiency is about 30%. The lab cell efficiency for CIGS is exceeding 20%. However, when we combine all the cells, become module, the percentage drop to 15.7%. Estimated production cost, still the same as CDTE technology, 3 ringgit 90 cents per watt. Problems, availability of indium and gallium, and the structure is quite sensitive. So we need to look for other material.
Okay, Re to rhenium.
Re, rhenium. RH, rhodium. Balik. IR?
Iridium.
Okay. Yes, iridium. Iridium. We use that metal for spark plug technology. Next. CZTS. CZTS. White tin. This is tin. Sternum is tin. So they are not rare. This is the structure. However, when we use non-rare metals, the best efficiency ever recorded is only 11% by IBM. Only 11.1%. It's already cheap, but efficiency is not that good. Cost. Good things doesn't come cheap. So this is the structure. It only the nerve. CZTS, CS, zinc oxide, aluminum and zinc oxide. And how do we deposit the CZTS? We could synthesis the CZTS nanoparticles using colloidal method or any other method that available that is cheap. Then these nanoparticles, we turn them into ink, ink type nanoparticles. Then we just spray the ink onto the surface of molybdenum. And then we sinter at 550 centigrade for 1 hour, then in the form of crystalline CZTS. And finally, this is the device. The CZTS, the molybdenum, the CS, the oxide. This is how the structure looks under VSAM. CZTS over here. This is the cross-sectional section of the CZTS solar cell. How do we synthesize CZTS? This is how we do it. This is known as one-pot synthesis. One-pot synthesis. Let's look at the fabrication technique. A solution of metal precursors is heated under argon flow for 1 hour. Metal precursors, meaning that the C, Z, and T, we mix C, Z, and T at certain concentration or certain percentage. preheat that under argon flow for 1 hour. Argon comes here, flow the argon, and heat up the metals of CZT for 1 hour. Why we put argon? We want to get rid of oxygen, nitrogen, and any other gases. We just want inert environment. We don't want the gas to react with our CZT. CZT are metals. S is not metal. S is chalcogenide. Chalcogenide.
Let's say you pick this point.
I want to test this sample. This sample at this point contain about 0.5%, between 50 and 50% of copper. This axis is copper. Kasih lihat pak. This axis is copper. This one is about 0.5% of copper. And that axis is sternum. 0.2%. Sorry, 20% of sternum. This axis is zinc. And this zinc is about 0.3% or 30% of zinc. Cara nak baca dia, yang sini ada mana? That axis slide over here. That axis slide over here. So this point contain 50% copper, 20% sternum, 30% zinc. So you make the solution using that value. Then you check using SRB, using FISAM, using what else? TEM, check the sample. And you can see that the sample doesn't form CZTS. It only forms zinc sulfide plus copper sulfide. We want CZTS. So this sample is unacceptable. It doesn't form CZTS. Then we move on to other sample. Check this point, check this point. At least you need 63 samples to be tested. And finally, only one single point that could produce CZTS, which contains 50% copper. What percent? 0.25,
right?
20%
25.
Sternum. And this one? 25% zinc. 50, 25, 25. Then you got pure CZT. Understand? Don't understand? Okay. It's like this. I use analogy, eh? Let's say you want to make pancake, lempeng. What do you need? You need flour, egg. Lempeng ada egg? Itu lempeng pantai timur. Garam. Air, tepung, garam. You need flour, you need salt, you need water. Salt. This axis is salt. This axis water, this axis is flour. If you use wrong ratio of water, flour and salt, can you do lempeng? Kadang-kadang terlalu cair, too dilute, too concentrated. You have to measure the exact composition that will make the perfect lempeng for yang amat gila something. We want that lempeng to be perfectly prepared. So you have to analyze using thermal reference diagram. Which composition will give you the perfect lempeng? Sometimes, if you use this composition, let's say this is the perfect lempeng. Let's say, if you use this composition, your lempeng is too soggy, too saggy, too much water, for example. Not perfect. Then you choose other point. Alamak, this lempeng is too rigid. Looks like roti canai. No. Fine. Then this is perfect. No crust. It is spongy, it is flexible, it is tasty, not too salty. Understand? So now turn that lempeng into CZT. We want CZT. We don't want ZS, we don't want CS. We want CZT. This is CZT. Only this point. CZT. Understand? This is lempeng plus air, we don't want. Understand? The analogy, right? Sebelah 20. So the summary of CZT technology is that theoretical efficiency 30%. However, the lab cell efficiency only 11.1%. So the module efficiency, no upscaling effort. Why? Why no upscaling effort? Because the cell efficiency is too low. 11% considered low. Scale up, effort will be started if the cell efficiency has reached 20%. Then the industry partner will say that yes, we would take up your project, we want to scale them up. If 11%, we want to scale up, this is cell. If make module, it will drop to below 10%, which is we could not get any significant profit from that device. Stability, not tested. Why? Because we don't have the finished product from the industry. Estimated production cost, cheap. We just estimate, it is cheap. We haven't tested in the industry yet. Problem, time and temperature. Time and temperature what? This one. We still need to optimize the temperature. Why 200? Why? Don't know, we just choose 200. We could optimize temperature. Maybe we could do this at lower temperature, 100. Time, why 20 minutes? Or we just simply use 20 minutes. Why can't we just use 10 minutes? Why we need 1 hour? We need to optimize that. So many factors still need to be optimized. Time and temperature. Stability is not tested. Complicated synthesis, even though it looks easy, but this part is not that easy. So many blood, tears, and sweat to produce this ternary phase diagram. Siapa yang dah buat ternary phase diagram dalam lab, tahulah kan? Itu pun how many samples?
9.
Itu pun dah menyumpah kan? I know, I have been trained before during my master degree. I need to prepare all the 63 samples within one day. I know the pain. Okay. Electronic inhomogeneity. Okay. Electronic inhomogeneity is that if we make error during the weighing process, we will form different type of ZT. Instead of ZT, maybe we could get ZNS and CO2S. This is very sensitive. Slight error, you will form something else. You use raw metals from other supplier with different quality, the output won't be as expected. So that is sensitive. Let's look at amorphous silicon, the last technology of tubular solar cell. What is the usage of amorphous silicon or hydrogenated amorphous silicon to power up our calculator or watch? So the advantages of amorphous, hydrogenated amorphous silicon is that we need lower amount of silicon, shorter time of fabrication, does not require high quality of crystal. In fact, the silicon is not crystal at all, it is amorphous, disordered crystal of silicon. These advantages of hydrogenated amorphous silicon is that amorphous silicon contains dangling bonds. What are they? I will explain after this, which acts as main recombination center of excited state electron. They are dangerous because the excited state electron easily could be recombined with the dangling bond. Poor doping capability of hydrogenated amorphous silicon. To get rid of the dangling bond, we need to introduce hydrogen. We force the hydrogen to make bond with the silicon to get rid of the dangling bond. However, after we have hydrogenated the amorphous silicon, the doping capability of the amorphous silicon will become poor. Why we need to dope them? Because we want to make the p-n junction. We need to dope with the p, we need to dope with the n. However, the hydrogenated amorphous silicon has poor doping capability. Very hard to dope them. So we still could dope them with the p and n material. However, after the doping process, we found out that the diffusion length of excited state electron is much, much shorter in the doped hydrogenated amorphous silicon. Diffusion length means that after the electron has been excited during absorption of light, the electron could not travel far inside the material or within the material. It could go at very short distance before it decombines with the holes. So, The monocrystalline silicon, the excited state electron, could travel about 300 micrometers before it recombined with the hole. But in hydrogenated amorphous silicon, the dope one, it only could travel about 0.1 micrometers. See, 100 becomes 0.1 micrometers. Very short distance. So, let us take a look what is dangling on. The figure A over here is the monocrystalline silicon. It is well ordered. It has organized periodic crystal structure with bond length. This is bond length. All the white circles are silicon atoms. And these are the bond length. We could easily say that each silicon needs to be bond with four other silicon. One, two, three, four. It will make bond with four other silicon. So this is monocrystalline silicon, and this is amorphous silicon. Amorphous silicon doesn't have any well-defined structure. And before that, this is bond length, this is bond angle, bond angle, bond angle, bond angle. What is dihedral angle? Dihedral angle is this one. Let's say our reference is these four atoms. One, two, three, four. This atom and this atom, they will form one plane. One plane. This atom and this atom will form another plane. So we have two planes like this. So how does these two planes interact with each other? Two planes. Does it interact like this? Or like this? Or these angles, these are dihedral angle. If you look from the front, it looks like no difference. But when you look from the side, there are differences. This is dihedral angle. So bond length, bond angle, and dihedral angle are well defined. They are mostly similar in monocrystalline silicon. But in amorphous silicon, there is no well-defined bond length. This bond length is different than this bond length. This bond length is different than this bond length. And this bond length, wait a minute, we don't have any bond length over here. So we have void. In amorphous silicon, we have void. As I mentioned before, silicon needs to make bond with four other silicons. But how about this silicon? It only make bond with three silicon. And we have dangling bond over here. And dangling bond is the unsatisfied valence. The electron which is in the outer valence, sorry, the valence orbit of the silicon which doesn't make any bond to any other atom. And it is called dangling bond. So dangling bond is dangerous because it acts as a recombination center for the excited state electron. The excited state electron will lose its energy to these dangling bonds. So we need to passivate the dangling bond. We need to get rid of the dangling bond. That's why we introduce with hydrogen. We force the hydrogen to make bond with the dangling bond. Then it is passivated. It is no longer act as main recombination center. The excited state electron doesn't interact with the hydrogenated dangling bond. Understand the flow? There is a flow. Again, monocrystalline silicon, perfect, top notch, however expensive. We need to find cheaper solution. We use amorphous silicon. But amorphous silicon contains dangling bond. It's not even crystal. It guaranteed has dangling bond. So get rid of dangling bond. How? Hydrogenated the dangling bond. But when we introduce hydrogen to the amorphous silicon, it will affect the doping capability. Why do we need doping? Because we want to create the PN junction. Okay, we try to dope them. Yes, it is hard, but we still could dope them. Then what is the result? The result is that after we have doped the hydrogenated amorphous silicon, the division length of excited electron is too small. How small? This small. This is monocrystalline. The excited electron will travel 300 micrometers. the dope heterogenated alpha silicon could only travel, the excited state neutron could only travel at 0.1 micrometer before it loses its energy and it combined with hole. Understand? So, okay, forget about this simulation, animation. Now, our problem in hydrogenated amorphous silicon is short diffusion length, which means after we have generated the excited state electron, the excited state electron could not travel far. It could only travel very short distance before it loses its energy. After it loses its energy, we could not generate electricity. The electron could not move anymore. So these are the mechanisms. Let us read. After absorption of light, which the energy of light is greater than the band gap, electrons are excited to conduction band. This is normal. Leaving holes at valence band. Traveling distance of the excited state electrons depends, one, on the structure. Example, Gratia. Organized crystals or chaotic amorphous. Structure means, is it crystal? Is it polycrystal? Is it amorphous? So the traveling distance of this excited state electron depends on the structure, whether it is crystal or polycrystal or amorphous. And doped before they recombine with hole at valence band. Okay? If we put doped in hydrogenated amorphous silicon, the ability of the excited state electron to travel more becomes, it could not travel as far as the undoped one. So diffusion length of excited silicon in amorphous silicon is shorter than that of the crystalline silicon. Diffusion length of excited silicon is even shorter in doped one. In any material, including the monocrystalline, when we dope them, the diffusion length also becomes shorter. So let us take a look at the structure. We have crystalline, polycrystalline, and amorphous. Well ordered, slightly disordered, but still we can see this is one crystal, this is one crystal, this is one more crystal, three crystals, this is one crystal, no crystal at all. One crystal domain, big domain of crystal. This is one domain of crystal. This is another, the second one domain, the second domain, this is the third domain of crystal. This one, no crystal. So what is the difference? This one is similar to the highway. One domain. This one is similar to KL. Okay, KL, so many junctions and traffic lights. This is the first road, Jalan Ampang. This is second road, Jalan Tunku Rahman. This is Jalan Imbi. So many junctions. So the electron travel at crystalline is similar highway, town road. This one pushes. So let's say your electron is a Ferrari with full tank of fuel. This is your excited state electron. So a car could travel many kilometers on a straight road before it stops due to fuel depletion. You could travel long straight road until your fuel has depleted and you measure the mileage. You could travel, for example, 1,000 kilometers. How about town road? So many junctions. With the same car, with the same amount of fuel. Sometimes you have to stop at the traffic light. Sometimes you have to turn left, turn left, turn right, go up to the flyover. Okay. Hold dulu ya. So if you change the car to an electron, any electron could travel many atomic distances here. The electron could travel many atomic distances before it stops due to recombination advancement. When it loses its energy after it ran out of fuel, which is the absorbed energy from the photon, it stops and recombines at valence band. This is the case of electron in crystal. Second case, polycrystalline. A car could travel lesser mileage on multi-junction road than that of a straight road before it runs out of fuel. If we translate it to electron, an electron could travel shorter atomic distances here in polycrystal than that of the monocrystalline due to shorter crystal periodic extension. Shorter crystal periodic extension could be imagined as short road before you meet with junction. Short road, travel short road, junction, turn right, then travel again, short road, stop, traffic light, turn left. That is crystal periodic extension. Jalan. Before it combines with pole advanced. So the electron will run out of juice, run out of the energy of photon if it travel in polycrystalline material. So how about if we bring our Ferrari at forest or bushes? A car could travel in meter scale in bush due to no specific road, except if we use caterpillar or excavator. Okay? Before it runs out of fuel, our car will start at certain point and we start to turn around to take another road before it runs out of fuel. So if we translate it to electron, an electron travels very short atomic distances due to shorter period of lattice than that of the polycrystal before it combines with pole advancement. It travels here, it turns left. It travels here, turns right. Travels here, turns down, up before it runs out of photon, energy from photon. Understand? Differences in crystal, polycrystal, and lattice. So this one, in crystalline silicon, high electron mobility. Electron could be traveled with many atomic distances, long diffusion length, lower electron mobility and shorter diffusion length than the crystalline. How about this one? The lowest electron mobility, the shortest diffusion length if we compare with that of the polycrystalline and crystalline. So, the only thing is that why do we still need dimorphos? Because it is cheap. That is the main reason. You want cheap? Okay, cheap. But the electron mobility is very low. The diffusion length is very short. How can we modify the device structure? We could use thinner layer of materials. Instead of using in a micrometer scale, we need to fabricate the layer in nanometer scale. This is the intrinsic hydrogenated amorphous silicon. I is intrinsic, the one with undoped. The undoped hydrogenated amorphous silicon, the diffusion length is longer. So we could make it, we make the layer about 300 nanometer. And how about the doped one, the p-doped and the n-doped? The diffusion length is very short, and therefore the thickness should not longer than the electron diffusion length. So it is already optimized. The best one is 20 nanometer for N type, 10 nanometer for the P type. We make them as thin as possible, and the thickness should be shorter than the diffusion length. So as I mentioned before, the dope one. The dope amorphous silicon, the electron diffusion length is 100 nanometer. It's 100 nanometer. The dope one, 100 nanometer. That is why our thickness for the dope is lesser than 100 nanometer. This is 20, this is 10. Understand? We need to make sure that this thick, this the thickness of the p-dope and n-dope should be lower than 100 nanometer. Because the electron diffusion length for the dope hydrogenated amorphous silicon is 100 nanometer. So this thickness must be 20 nanometer. If we put 100 nanometer or 200 nanometer over here, the device won't work. Cannot generate electricity. So this is the criteria. How do we know which thickness is suitable? Make sure it is lesser than the electron diffusion length, or else the electron cannot travel. Instead of use PN junction, we use PIN. Why do we need I? Usually we will use p-n junction, but this time we need I. Why in the world we need iron? It is because the 20 nanometer of N, 10 nanometer of P cannot absorb light very strongly. It cannot absorb light efficiently because too thin, the light could pass through the material, cannot be absorbed. So that is the function of the intrinsic hydrogenated amorphous silicon as backup layer to absorb, because it is quite thick, 300 nanometer. It could absorb light quite better than the P and N though, hydrogenated amorphous silicon. We use PIN instead of PN in the hydrogenated amorphous silicon solar cell. I think we continue our lesson. Okay, saya akan belajar kan? Okay, that's all for today.